So what's the deal with precancerous lesions, precancerous conditions, and oral potentially malignant disorders? Certain red, white, or red-white lesions of the oral cavity have a potential or a higher risk to develop malignancy. Let us, for the sake of clarity, understand that these lesions could be precursors to oral squamous cell carcinoma. In other words, these lesions or diseases could be defined as those that have altered the epithelium and have an increased likelihood of becoming oral squamous cell carcinoma. Since they were precursors to oral cancer, World Health Organization in 1972 identified two types of oral diseases. A precancerous lesion, defined as a morphologically altered tissue in which cancer is more likely to occur than in its apparently normal counterpart. And a precancerous condition, defined as a generalized state associated with a significantly increased risk of cancer. But why classify these as precancerous lesions and conditions? At that time, this classification was not just academic. It was thought that malignancy occurring from a precancerous lesion would appear in the same site as the precancer lesion, like leukoplakia or erythroplakia, for example. Whereas, malignancy could develop anywhere in the oral cavity or pharynx if the individual suffered from a precancerous condition, like oral lichen planus or oral submucous fibrosis. However, it was later understood that these lesions or conditions had only a potential risk to become cancer. The malignant transformation was not inevitable. A patient with leukoplakia need not necessarily develop oral squamous cell carcinoma. Moreover, it was also found that for a patient with a defined lesion such as leukoplakia, malignancy could arise elsewhere in the oral cavity. Now, this is in opposition to the idea that oral squamous cell carcinoma would appear in the same site as the oral precancerous lesion as defined by World Health Organization in 1972. These arguments make the classification of these oral diseases as precancerous lesions and conditions redundant. At a World Health Organization workshop in 2005, it was recommended that the distinction between precancerous lesions and conditions be abandoned in favor of a common term called oral potentially malignant disorders. Is epithelial dysplasia a significant predictor of malignant transformation of oral potentially malignant disorders? Well, it sort of is and is not. Now, before you get confused, let me explain. It has to be remembered that it is not inevitable that a dysplastic lesion will transform into oral cancer. There is evidence of dysplastic lesions not progressing to carcinoma and also oral potentially malignant disorders without dysplasia progressing to oral cancer. However, the microscopic evaluation for the presence of epithelial dysplasia in oral potentially malignant disorders remains the gold standard for the assessment of these lesions. It is believed that oral potentially malignant disorders with epithelial dysplasia have more chances of malignant transformation. Besides epithelial dysplasia, can the site and clinical appearance of an oral potentially malignant disorder like leukoplakia be a predictor of malignant transformation? Absolutely. They are significant predictors of malignant transformation. Lesions on the buccal mucosa have been found to have low malignant transformation rates, whereas lesions on the lateral borders, ventral surface of the tongue, and floor of the mouth have been found to have higher malignant transformation rates. Now, as far as clinical appearance is concerned, non-homogeneous lesions, especially those white lesions that have red components, have a higher malignant transformation rate than homogeneous lesions. Research has shown that most early oral cancers are red or white lesions with red components. Mm-hmm.